Good afternoon, everybody. Once again, this is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are still keeping the Sabbath, Shabbat Shalom. Now, this video is basically going to continue from the last video I just did a little while ago titled Scripture Please, which was a follow-up to a reply that I got off the video I did last week, Character. And I ended this last video, Scripture Please, with this statement from the young lady who replied to me again once I responded to the first response. And she said, "Thank you for explaining, but aren't we made righteous in Christ the moment we accept Him as our Lord and Savior? For example, what if a smoker is dying from lung cancer and someone comes to preach the gospel to that person and they decide to accept Christ, but dies the next day, unable to quit smoking? Are you saying he'll have that habit in heaven?" And I said, "We'll see." Now, my response to her was this. I put, "Let's start here. Smoking may seem like a small thing, but what is the possible consequences of smoking? Cancer, as she stated, that person had. This is a sin because what? It is destroying the Father's temple. We choose to possibly acquire something like cancer because we give in to the, what, initial temptation of smoking. Now, because of that giving in, we have the enemy in our lives. We give him a foothold to get in our lives. And he has a certain amount of power over us now. Now, to overcome this habit is where the true battle starts. We are once again back to choice or free will. But in our disobedience, the difficulty level in doing right has risen exponentially," which it does. When we allow sin into our lives, to get out of it is that much more multiplied, tougher. These are situations in which we should choose to gravitate toward the Father in trust and faith instead of whining and crying about things are too hard to stop doing, because that's what we do. "Oh, it's hard. I can't stop doing it. I tried. I give up." We get into these situations, but then we say they're too hard. We're following what the enemy wants us to do. He wants us to say it's too hard and I can't do it, because we keep allowing him to have power when we do and say things like that. Look, no sin gets a free pass. We pay for it ourselves, or we curse someone with it, our husband, our wife, our household, our children, or you may even pass that on to their children, your grandchildren. You never know. Sin has to be accounted for. There has to be a price paid for every sin. Don't ever forget that. Just because you think you've gotten away with something scot-free, something may happen down the road to you, a loved one, or what have you. We never know. But the thing with cancer is, if you smoke, you've chose to possibly shorten your life instead of living the long, fruitful life that the Father intended for you. That's already just one consequence. So with that, let's get into the rest of this story.
Turn away and
change.
Okay, everybody, let's talk repentance. Bottom line, we must change now while we have opportunity. You must turn from all your sinful ways and turn toward the Father's way and live your life according to how He wants us to live our life. If you believe nothing else, believe that no sin will ever enter into the kingdom of heaven. The Father's word says that over and over and over. None of it shall inherit the kingdom of the Father. So if you think that you can die in a sinful state and make it to heaven, you are being deceived by the enemy and yourself. Don't be deceived like that. Now, even the Father is even said to have repented. Go with me to Genesis 6:6. And it reads, it says, "And it repented the Lord that he made man on earth, and it grieved him at his heart." Why? Because of all the wicked and sinful things that mankind was doing. Even so much, it included the beast. 7, verse 7 reads, it says, "And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping thing, and the fowls of the air, for it repented me that I have made them." There was some wickedness going on. Use your imagination. It says every imaginable thing was going on. So that's what they were doing. But this can only be understood by what? The Father altering his behavior toward his creatures, either bestowing good upon them or inflicting evil upon them. And by the manner of men, the Father is said to have repented. He made some changes. Now, in a generic sense, even Esau found no place for repentance, though he went after it with tears. Both me in Hebrews 12:17. It reads, it says, "For ye know that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears." See, he couldn't even move his father Isaac to repent of what he had done, or to recall the blessing from Jacob that was meant for him. Romans 11:29 read like this. It says, "For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance." That is why Esau's father, Isaac, could not take back the blessing that he had given to Jacob, who, by the way, tricked him into doing so, but that's another story. So even Esau going to his father tearfully and begging and pleading for the blessing couldn't be done. So he couldn't change that. Okay, stay with me. I'm going to explain the two different types of repentance, because we're all familiar with the two types. Now, one type of repentance probably denotes your recollecting your own actions in such a manner as to produce sorrow as you review with a sincere desire to make an amendment or change to whatever has been done. It's strictly a change of your mind, and it includes the whole of that situation with respect to your views, disposition, and conduct, which is affected by what? By the word of the Heavenly Father, by the gospel. Now, the second type merely signifies your a person's anxiety and uneasiness upon the consideration of what is done. That's the second type. So, the first form signifies a change founded on a reconsideration of principles, and the second, a concern founded on the view of consequences. So the first is about principles, and the second type is about consequences. So a lot of times people will do things based on consequences as opposed to principles. Keep in mind, the first is thorough and the second is only a partial, and that is ineffectual. The law of the Father is in fact an essential instrument in producing a sincere heavenly repentance, or godly, as people like to say, a godly repentance. The real difference is much better expressed in the terms of worldly and godly, because that's what people are used to hearing. But moreover, it has a scriptural sanction. Go with me to 2 Corinthians 7, and we're going to read verses 9 and 10. And they read, "Now I rejoice not that ye were made sorry, but that ye sorrowed to repentance. For ye were made sorry after a godly manner, that ye might receive damage by us in nothing." Verse 10, "For godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of, but sorrow of the world worketh death." So both types are mentioned here. There's the godly repentance that leads to salvation, and then there's the worldly repentance that leads to death. Because the worldly repentance will lead you to a unrighteous death. So that's what it's speaking of. It's going to lead you to that second death. Now, a worldly or a partial repentance is one that is grieved for and turns from, has an individual turn from outward sin merely on the account of the hurt that it has done or that it's likely to do him. And the point is, he still loves his sin and repents of doing it because it brings him punishment. That's the only reason that some people will refrain from doing things that are sinful, is because of the punishment associated with. See, it's not about their salvation. They're not looking at it in a heavenly sense. So therefore, he or she never truly turns away from it because they weren't sincere towards doing it in the heavenly, with the heavenly approach in the first place. And they didn't taking account that it's about their salvation. So after a while, the same old thing will crop up and they will repeat the same sins over and over and over, because the enemy will see to it that you do. Because this sin will take you over unless you get rid of it with the heavenly power. Now, secondly, a heavenly repentance, which is a pious sorrow carried in the heart by the sinner, by the word of the Father. Now, he's fully aware, or the sinner is fully aware of his sin, as it is offensive to the heavenly Father and everything thereof, and is defiling and endangering to his own soul, and from his apprehension of the mercy from the Father, he or she with grief. You go with a grief and a hatred of all your own sins. You turn to the Father as the Savior, as your Savior and your Father. You turn to them. This is called a heavenly repentance, as you turn from sin to him and from repentance unto life. Now, this leads to what? A spiritual life. And it is what? The first step to an eternal life. We must turn away from sin in this type of repentance. Not because we're concerned about the consequences or the pain it may bring us. That is a fake or false repentance. Or it's a sincere worldly repentance, but it's never going to get you into the kingdom. So don't front with your repentance, because if it's not sincere, it's going to come back up, and you're never fooling the Father with it. Matthew 3:2 reads like this. It reads, "And saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And in Daniel 2:44, it tells us that the Father's kingdom will what? It will consume all the kingdoms of the world, and it will stand forever. So it's up to each one of us to decide when we want to turn away from our own wicked ways and turn unto salvation. We have to do it with a sincere and contrite heart, or we will never succeed, and we'll be one of those ones wandering around going, "It's hard, I can't stop doing this." Now, most people have heard of this scripture, Acts 3:19, but most people aren't listening or really discerning what it's saying. So here we go. It reads, it says, "Repent ye therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of the refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. And be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." That's Acts 2:28. I just read it in continuation with that, because when you have reference, they just flow together like that. One references the other, so you can read them together. And this is how part of the discernment comes. This is how you get that wisdom from the Word. Through referencing, it puts them together so you understand what the Father's Word is saying. Now, notice in Acts 3:19 it reads, it says, "may be blotted out." So remember that bedside prayer, that last minute prayer and accepting of the Father that a lot of people think they're going to have the opportunity to get. Even if they do, like the smoker that Miss Fernanda was making comment to in her response to me, even if you do, even if you are afforded the opportunity to be on a deathbed and accept the Father and all this, it says that your sins may be blotted out. Now, don't get it confused, people. The Father, like I said, he will forgive us for our sins, but the Word says that our sins may be blotted out. There has to be a payment for every sin we make. We can't live our lives wickedly and then think at the last minute that we're going to be allowed to clearly enter into heaven. If the Word says, may be blotted out. So keep that in mind. We have a work to do. We have a life we have to live in the meantime. So don't be naive and play with the Word of the Father. His Word is simple and clear. Anything here on earth right now has to be sin-free and in perfection to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Nothing containing one drop of sin will ever enter into the kingdom of heaven. So don't fool yourself, and don't be fooled by the enemy. Now, James 2:20 tells us this. It says, "But wilt thou, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by the works faith made perfect. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. So what this is saying is, don't be vain in thinking that we don't have a work to do. I've said it before, people, we have to do the Father's work, not ours. Our work will get us nowhere. We have to do work that is of the Father's will. See, Abraham was justified by doing the Father's work. He sacrificed in obedience. He was willing to sacrifice his own son according to what the Father had commanded him. He's doing the work of the Father in faith and in love. James 2:24 continues and reads like this. Ye see how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. See, Abraham was justified by works and his faith, not by faith only. See, people can walk around all day saying they have faith, but if they aren't putting in the work, it will reveal itself. Now, like I said, keep in mind there are two types of repentance. The worldly type we see every day, or the heavenly or godly type, which is what we all need to adhere to. The word is out. We must change while we can and not toy with the Father and his word, because in the end, there are only going to be two classes of people, the righteous and the unrighteous, or wicked, or whatever you want to call them. This is Brother Lloyd, and we must change, desiring the power of the Almighty within our heart with sincerity and faith, or it's just lip service. So, know what you believe, why you believe it, and where to find it. I'm out.